So welcome to part 6 of the lecture on competing reactions. We are heading now for part 6 of the article of Professor Sierra about dead ends and detours in total synthesis. And there is one factor, the problems with stereochemistry. Problems which one has not, maybe not foreseen. So, here in this first reaction, it's about the reduction of a carbonyl group. So, how would we perform such a reduction? Usually, sodium borohydride as a relatively mild reducing agent is sufficient, and indeed sodium borohydride in methanol, you can apply this complex hydride even in such acidic solvents. You have to use it in excess, and done at 0 degrees, a nice 90% yield of this secondary alcohol was obtained. Unfortunately, it is not the stereoisomer which was needed. So we have the wrong stereochemistry at this position. And are in need of this one. So, can we explain the outcome of this reaction? Well, as we know, the hydride should attack the carbonyl group with a trajectory of the Bürgi-Dunitz angle, 107 degrees, either from here or from behind the blackboard. However, in this case, with those two hydrogens behind the blackboard, we have a roof-like appearance of that molecule. And yeah, well, from here, it's like that. There are the hydrogens, and here is the roof, okay? So that means that the reducing agent should also approach from behind the blackboard, finally leading to the hydroxyl group in front of the blackboard, okay? So, for having a chance that we get the opposite stereoisomer, then we would have to change the mechanism. And one way to do so is trying a reduction under Birch-like reaction conditions. For instance, sodium in liquid ammonia, going for SET, single electron transfer processes. Well, they tried that. It was the group of Amos B. Smith, a very famous group for total synthesis, and tried these Birch-like reaction conditions. You, some of you at least, have practiced in the undergraduate lab for mainly used for the reduction of phenyl derivatives to unconjugated dihydrobenzene derivatives. So they tried it, but in vain, it didn't work. So what else could one do? There is the so-called Mitsunobu reaction. Very interesting reaction. We should have a look for the mechanism and the ingredients we need for that. Well, we first of all need azo dicarboxylic acid diester. Normally or very often abbreviated as DAT, diethyl azo dicarboxylate. So, and this is treated with triphenylphosphine. So, what will happen in that case? Triphenylphosphine is a soft nucleophile. Those who already attended the lecture on catalytic organometallics know that we had this example of the isomerization of enones to dienones, formerly thought to be catalyzed by palladium acetate, and later on Barry Trost's group found out it was a phosphine catalyzed process. Were the ligands at the metals that did the job. So, also here, attacking this conjugated system, just as a nucleophile, all this happens in equilibrium, and we now have formally a positive charge as at the phosphine, and here the nitrogen anionic charge, but in the presence of a carboxylic acid, this will get protonated. And then we, of course, have the carboxylate as the counter anion. The Mitsunobu reaction is a reaction for activating alcohols for a nucleophilic substitution. Primary and secondary alcohols for SN2 reactions. So we also have an alcohol present. So the alcohol then reacts with this phosphonium reagent. Making use of the oxophilicity of the phosphine. So, let me think about it. I think we can skip that retro process. So, what had happened? Obviously, the azo dicarboxylate has been reduced to the hydroxyno compound. On the other hand, the phosphine has been oxidized within this redox process. Now, as I said, generally this oxygen was formerly part of a secondary or primary alcohol. That means here that substituent R is an aliphatic one. Well, at least it is C3 hybridized carbon here. In such cases, an SN2 process could take place and does indeed with that carboxylate as the nucleophile. Producing triphenylphosphine oxide on the one hand and an ester like that on the other hand. Because it is an SN2 process, the stereo information at that center is inversed. And this is the important factor why Mitsunobu reaction is so interesting in this case. Do we already know a similar reaction like that? Yes, indeed, from Organic Chemistry 1, the Abusov reaction. So I hope you remember having, for instance, benzyl bromide let that react with this nice reagent, then the phosphine as a nucleophile reacts here . So, also a phosphonium with a bromide counter anion in this case. And now I hope you see the parallel situation. Here we have a leaving group, a good leaving group, similar to the Mitsunobu reaction. Now not the carboxylate, it would also work with a carboxylate, but now with a bromide. And even the bromide is nucleophilic enough to make that substitution reaction. Bromoethane is produced, and this phosphonic acid ester, which then can later on be applied in Wittig type, Wittig, Horner, Emmons, and so on type processes after deprotonating here. Okay, so that's why there is some parallelity between the Mitsunobu reaction and the Abusov reaction. So, what about here? Well, okay, make a Mitsunobu process here, nucleophilic substitution with a carboxylate, hydrolyze that ester, and you should have the OH group on the other side. Okay? To this product. They tried it and, well, didn't work. So, we couldn't get this done, so we had to decide to go for a different approach. So, we did so. In the first step, they applied an interesting reagent. I would guess most of you haven't seen that before. It's the so-called Davies reagent. And from its structure, it's an oxaciridine. So, three-membered nitrogen heterocycle is an aziridine, and having an oxa group in there, meaning exchanging a methylene group by an oxygen, yeah, means it's an oxaziridine. And this oxaziridine has a nice property that it can deliver this oxygen and oxidize that molecule. So, which part of a molecule is most easily oxidized? It's, of course, the sulfur. So, in that case, we will get to the sulfoxide. I hope you remember from Organic Chemistry 2 another interesting reagent for delivering oxidatively one oxygen. It's a three-membered heterocycle. It's this dimethyl dioxirane. Very nicely produced, and it delivers the oxygen, and then acetone remains, which is not that acidic. This is the advantage compared to MCPBA, where you have a carboxylic acid remaining then. And moreover, would like to remind you of the Xi epoxidation. Developed by Professor Yi-Yan Shi, where he first oxidizes within a sugar moiety, a keto functionality, with a caroate. This is the peroxo sulfur compound, which deliver first, would also oxidize acetone to dimethyl oxyrane. And this moiety you have then within the chiral part of the sugar molecule. And the Xi epoxidation is then an epoxidation where the chiral information, an enantioselective epoxidation where the chiral information stems from the sugar molecule. So let's go on here. The idea is that we eliminate water here. This is already more acidic by the oxidation. But first of all, we have to transform the hydroxy group into a better leaving group, and standard procedure there is treating it with methyl chloride, the presence of a base, mixture of triethylamine and dimethylaminopyridine, DMAP in dichloromethane. And third, then an additional stronger base the DBU diazo bicyclo undecane. Some of you I know use that regularly. For the others, I'm going to draw that structure here. Let's see. And this free electron pair at that nitrogen is the basic center, because after protonation we have then the conjugated cation. So overall, eliminating water means Amos B. Smith group was heading for this olefin. But for the final product, we are in need not of the sulfoxide, but a reduced one. So how could you reduce that without affecting that double bond? There is a nice reagent. It is trifluoroacetic anhydride in acetone, and the reducing agent is sodium iodide. It transfers that cell phone in principle in this diodo compound, which then will lose simply iodine. So the sulfur is reduced, and on the other hand, the iodide is oxidized to iodine. Next step. This is simply a hydroboration in THF followed by the usual oxidation under basic conditions sodium hydroxide and hydrogen peroxide. And as you know, this oxidation of the organoborone compound works with under retention. And since the hydroboration will take place on top of a roof, so axo, not endo, that means the bore will sit here behind the blackboard, and therefore, finally, the hydroxyl group 2. And this is just the stereoisomer the Smith group was aiming for to get to the final natural product. It's some steps more, of course. Let us better go to the next example. Still about problems with stereochemistry. Coleman's group wanted to synthesize a molecule with a chiral axis and wanted to synthesize that enantioselectively. To be precise, they needed a diastereoselectivity since there was already a chiral center present. So, two of those molecules, first treated with butyllithium, you will get it lithiated at this position, then offering copper cyanide, copper 1 cyanide as TMEDA complex. This at low temperatures. And then oxidizing, still at that low temperature, with molecular oxygen. So, what will happen? You will form a diaryl cuprate, and with the oxidation, you will induce, in principle, an Ullmann coupling. Reductive elimination forming an Ullmann coupling product. So, and by the Ullmann coupling step, the B-aryl axis is introduced. Let's see. So here we have the chiral axis, and it looks like that. This methoxy group is outside the blackboard. The other methoxy group is inside the blackboard. Well, the chiral information is R, the A is for axial. Let's see, I have to check the chiral information on that side. Yeah, it's the same as here. Okay. So, R selectivity, that means just by chance this point chiral information has influenced here the diastereoselective formation of that axis. This is nice, almost pure. The R stereoisomer, unfortunately, it was the wrong one. We were in need of the S axis. So, without drawing that whole thing once again, I just will explain how we did it. And it was rather easy. We thought, nice, it works, highly diastereoselective. So, if we change it here and go and start with the other enantiomer, we should consequently get to the S diastereoisomer, S at that axis. But then, of course, the chiral information here is wrong. But it is more easy to epimerize here to get to the other stereoisomer at the point chiral center than at the chiral axis. You can, of course, racemize here by heating it up, but it's not what you want to. Okay? So, and we now know a method how to change the chiral information here to the opposite. It's there, the Mitsunobu reaction. So, these R groups have been protecting groups. They cleaved the protecting groups off, made a double Mitsunobu reaction here and there, and finally got the right diastereoisomer. Okay. In addition, I would like to show you another approach for chiral axis. This developed by Bruce Lipschutz. He is one of the pioneers of sophisticated copper chemistry. Well, in Santa Barbara in 1993. So, this bromo naphthol was coupled with this chiral compound, and of course, you all notice that you can easily synthesize this starting from tartaric acid, right? So reducing the acid functionality and putting on benzyl protecting groups and coupling that to give this molecule. Is achieved also with a Mitsunobu type reaction, making leaving groups out of that and having then the phenolate attacking as the nucleophile. So now we have a bromide, an aryl bromide, and an aryl bromide here. And this was used for an intramolecular Ullmann coupling. Actually, the same conditions as we have discussed before. So, butyllithium, and then copper cyanide, and then oxidation. Forming the biaryl axis. All was achieved with 78% yield. So here, in the Lipschutz group, they had first Mitsunobu, then formation of a biaural axis, and in the example before, we had first the Ullmann coupling, then the Mitsunobu, strangely. So, cleaving that part off, will give the chiral enantiomerically pure binaphthol. I hope you all know how normally binaphthol is synthesized. It's beta-naphthol treated with iron 3 chloride as an one electron oxidant, and it is normally treated as solid pistol and mortar, and heating it up to maybe 50 degrees. That's enough. It gives excellent yield of the racemic binaphthol, and this has to be then separated in its enantiomers. So, that cleavage worked very well, and as reagents, that Lipschutz paper was telling first NBS secondly OH minus. I was thinking, is that some special method I haven't heard about? Well, they don't tell, and in SciFinder I found only this example exclusively. I think they have invented it for that and didn't tell anything more about it. So we could guess what will happen there. There is NBS looks like radical process, at least if they have AIBN also there. Just NBS and some acid, then you would get electrophilic aromatic bromination. Yeah. Here, nothing should happen there, but in the side chain, so I assume we mean that it's a radical process. So, where will the bromine radically be attached preferentially? Normally in benzyl position. I think that will happen. But nevertheless, here we have also, in principle, tertiary hydrogens. And if you can also brominate here and there, substitute that then in a nucleophilic substitution with hydroxylate, you will get two hemiacetals. And in equilibrium, they will just fall apart and you get nicely that product. Okay, that's at least my guess how this cleavage works. Next subject, the seventh And last subject following Sarah's article about dead ends and, as I said, D2s in total synthesis. Reluctant ring closure. So ring closures that, well, don't want to proceed. One example which in principle could also be an example for problems with stereochemistry . We have a ketone functionality here and an aldehyde there. And this has been treated with titanium trichloride in dimethoxyethane. In the presence of zinc copper as reducing agent, 45 hours room temperature. So, what do you think will happen? Well, first guess will always be McMurray reaction. Okay? But under moderate reaction conditions with titanium trichloride, it is possible to halfway stop the McMurray reaction and to go for the pinacol coupling products, for the pinacols. And this is indeed the case here. Pinacol formation . So it was indeed planned to have a pinacle there, since this reaction has been performed in the lab of the expert for McMurray type processes, McMurray's lab itself. They knew what they were doing, but they were also doing it by chance, going for certain stereoisomers. This was one of four isolated isomers which could be identified, and it is the one with the highest yield, 21%. Well, they also used this one, this stereo information, for producing or synthesizing a certain natural product. But the one they had originally in mind had exactly the opposite stereo information at those centers. So the OH groups in front, both in front. This was unfortunately only isolated with 7% yield. So three times as much with this. And so the McMurray group tried to isomerize both positions, and they did that successfully, again with mesyl chloride and pyridine as base. So then, of course, the secondary alcohol will be methylated in preference. And then, secondly, treating that with a stronger base. They got this epoxide . So they changed the stereo information already at this position. And then, next step. H2O with that perchloric acid. Protonating here, and the water nucleophile coming from the other side. Finally, having changed both positions. First step with 68% yield, and the second step with 77%. So a double stereo inversion. Last example for today. Again, a ring closure reaction. Which didn't work as it was planned to do. An interesting spirocyclic system. A quinone in the center, an easily cleavable protecting group at the nitrogen. Well, it is, I think, a rather interesting protecting group, abbreviated as TEOC. And this is that kind of group. So. An amide from carbon dioxide with this side chain, and of course, if you would treat that with some fluoride, then ethylene would be eliminated, the carboxylate, and having here the nitrogen, well, okay, it then will lose CO2. Okay, easily to be cleaved. They hoped for the direct condensation, since this is the natural product . So, but it didn't work. Two reasons can be discussed or should be discussed. Maybe a steric interaction, however. Here we have that spirocycle. And of course, this is standing like that. One in front and one goes behind. But it is not standing right perpendicular there, but a bit like that. That means that those hydrogens might point a little bit to this and that position there, yeah? And just having still some hindrance around the carbon dioxide. I think if one would put in a model into the computer, which is, this will be easy to notice. But even more important, presumably, are these electronic interactions. Since that carbonyl here, you could see as a double vinyligous urea conjugated to that amine and this amino group. Okay? So, and the solution to the problem was avoiding this spirocycle at the cyclization step and making changes here at both positions concerning that nitrogen and that nitrogen, making that carbonyl here somewhat more electrophilic. Having a methoxy group here, tosylating this nitrogen, and having here the protected carbon. With para-toluol sulfonic acid in acetonitrile, a 51% yield was obtained of the cyclized product. Well, a couple of steps had to follow. Most important step was using this nucleophile, attacking here with an addition elimination process. Having then this side chain and then oxidatively coupling at this position to the spiral cycle. Well, okay, I think this is enough for today. Thanks for listening. See you next week, Tuesday.